Okay, so this, this forum on, state dependence, bulk reconstruction, black hole interiors, the goal is to try to bring in more participants in the discussion. So the organization is each of the four speakers will, give a concise presentation of their viewpoint in about 10 minutes. Only interruptions during that period should be just to clarify what they're saying. Then in the following 10 minutes, we can sort of discuss specifically their perspective. And then after all four have laid out their perspective and we've discussed it, we'll have an open discussion about, well, where it all leads us and leaves us. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you. And as Ted said, I tried to address, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about state dependence but among a small set of people. And so I tried to address this to a larger, you know, to a larger group. So some of this might be elementary for those of you who are following this, but hopefully not all. So before I start, I just wanted to, you know, one of the objectives of this very brief presentation is at least to try and get the terminology right and try and get everyone on the same page as to what the issues are. So the first thing, I guess, to point out is that we are talking a lot about state dependence, but what is it that's state dependent? You know, what are the observables that we're discussing that are state dependent? So in particular, you know, the observables that we're interested in that happen to, you know, on which this debate on state dependence happens to be happening is an observable which is classically or semi-classically a well-defined gauge invariant observable in the bulk. So in particular, the kind of physical process we are thinking about is you start from some point in the boundary, which is given by time and some position on the sphere. You jump in, you're carrying a clock with you, or you're carrying some other measurement device with you, and you wait for a certain affine parameter or a certain proper time, and then you measure the field or you measure some other local excitation. And that's the kind of object that we're talking about. And this kind of object, it's a non-local observable because it's framed to the boundary, but we expect that this is the closest approximation we can get, at least semi-classically, to local bulk observables. And then the question is, you know, what happens when you measure this, and can you describe this process of measurement within the conformal field theory? Now, when you do this, you can take this field that's labeled, as I said, by a boundary point T and omega, and some affine parameter lambda that tells you how far along the geodesic you went, and you can break it up into its modes in terms of this time and in terms of some other these other parameters, and there you get behind the horizon both left moving modes and right moving modes, and these are the right moving modes behind the horizon. They're the waves that go this way, and these are the variables. These are some modes of the field behind the horizon, which is supposed to be state dependent. So I think it's important to keep in mind first what the question that we're asking for is. It's a conceptually well-defined question. It's defined in this conceptually gauge invariant manner. And then the question is, you know, how do you describe these variables in the CFT? So there's a precise construction of these variables, which I'll try and describe, and I'll try and tell you in what sense it's state dependent. And that construction goes as follows. So imagine that you're in a certain microstate of the black hole. So we're always considering states of the CFT in which there's a black hole in the bulk. Imagine that you're in a certain microstate of the black hole. And then it's important to introduce in this construction of these O tilde operators, it's important to introduce this notion of what we call a little Hilbert space. And the little Hilbert space is a subspace of the full Hilbert space of the CFT that corresponds to all possible physical effective field theory excitations you can make of this black hole microstate. And there's a precise way to formulate that. The statement is you start with this black hole microstate, you act in it with modes of single trace operators in the boundary, products of such modes, you know, multi-products of such modes, but you have to put a cutoff so that the total number of products you have, you know, is smaller than the central charge of the CFT, and the energy of each such mode is also smaller, much smaller than n. And if you do that, that's an excitation, that's a reasonable excitation within effective field theory. And the set of all such excitations above this original black hole microstate gives you a subspace of the full Hilbert space. And this is what we call the little Hilbert space. So little Hilbert space is the one in dark pink, as opposed to this off-white thing outside, which is the big Hilbert space. Okay? And the claim is that if you jump into a black hole when it's in the microstate psi, all you need to care about is this little Hilbert space and not the big Hilbert space. On this little Hilbert space, we have a proposed definition of what these O tilde operators are. And the details of this proposed definition are not so important for now, but I'll just tell you briefly. The way it goes is you have a map, some antilinear map, that takes you from the little Hilbert space, see, this is an excitation of the microstate back to some other excitation of the microstate. And in terms of this antilinear S math, you can precisely define these O tilde operators. And this delta is also something that I could tell you more about, but it's something that one can specify precisely. And the point is that you can take this O tilde and plug it back in the mode expansion that I wrote on the first slide. And the phi operator that you get using this O tilde is a linear operator on the little Hilbert space. Okay, it's a linear operator on the little Hilbert space. And also you can verify, importantly, that it has the correct effective field theory correlators when it's evaluated, you know, in correlation functions about the original microstate psi. Okay, so that's what these observables are. Now, why do we say they're state dependent?
Question.
Yes.
For clarity,
yes.
Can you go back?
Yes.
So antilinearity requires that you have a basis state where the basis states are not...
This is the basis state psi, and then you have an excitation. So this E alpha psi gives you a basis of the little Hilbert space.
But you,
and
so, this is the so you had to choose some preferred basis.
You had to choose a state psi, yes.
Okay.
Yes, you have to choose, yes.
And the algebra for A alphas have real coefficients.
The algebras for A alphas here do not necessarily have to have real coefficients. It's an antilinear map. So now the full Hilbert space that you get, why do we say it's state dependent? It's because if you look at the full Hilbert space, the big space, it can be covered in terms of a number of these little Hilbert spaces. So if you're about a microstate psi 2, there's some excitations you can make about that. If you're about some other microstate psi 1, there's some excitations you can make about that. And the full Hilbert space can be covered with a number of these little Hilbert spaces, each of which is relevant to experiments done about the black hole in a particular microstate psi. And the reason we say it's state-dependent doesn't have to do with the inherent properties of this construction, but rather with the AMPSS paradoxes. And we believe that the correct way to interpret the AMPSS paradoxes is that no single linear operator O tilde can be written down that behaves correctly and interpolates correctly between all of these little Hilbert spaces. So in particular, you can write down the description of O tilde within one of these little Hilbert spaces here or here or here or here. But if you ask for a single linear operator that behaves correctly on the full Hilbert space, then the claim is that there is no such operator. And if you want to describe the experience of the black hole of the infalling observer falling into this microstate, you need to use one operator, and you may need to use a different operator for the infalling observer falling into, you know, excitations about a different microstate. Okay. So that's what it means for things to be state dependent. Now you could ask, why is state dependence surprising? You know, why would you expect things to be state independent? And the reason, I think the best reason I know of at least, comes from canonical gravity, which tells you that within canonical gravity, if you're trying to quantize gravity and you ask for relationally defined observables, such as a metric at a point that's relationally defined with respect to the bulk, then such an observable would be a linear operator on the entire Hilbert space. So that's the best reason to expect that you would be able to describe, you know, things like a relationally defined metric operator, metric fluctuation at a point, in terms of a linear operator on the full Hilbert space.
What do you mean by relationally defined?
Relationally defined is what I said at the beginning, where you start from the boundary and you jump in for some time, so you frame things with respect to the boundary. So it's a relational definition, you know, with respect to the... So that's the context in which I'm using it. But canonical gravity, but you might suspect this intuition, and the reason is that canonical gravity doesn't see all the black hole microstates, and so in making this, you're in some sense taking canonical gravity, you know, past its regime of validity, because you have to work in a frame where canonical gravity does see all the black hole microstates, and there is no such frame. Okay? And so, in a sense, and by the way, the fact that the canonical gravity intuition is valid in a certain approximation is a statement that it is valid within the little Hilbert space, which is something that you would see if you quantize fields about the background of a black hole. So what you would see if you did that quantum mechanics is canonical gravity in the little Hilbert space. And by construction, these observables are, you know, behave like ordinary linear observables within that little Hilbert space. And the corollary of that is that no infalling observer can detect state dependence by doing experiments within effective field theory. Now you could ask, you know, what it means for things to be, what's the broader significance of the fact that things are state dependent, or these violations of the bond rule that many of us have discussed. And the statement is that conceptually, you know, if you try and ask for what is the observable in the CFT that corresponds to a conceptually well-defined bulk operator, such as, you know, the metric operator at some point behind the horizon, then the answer to such a question is given by something that's a nonlinear CFT operator if you examine it on the full Hilbert space. So this is not the statement that you're turning the Schrodinger equation into something nonlinear or adding nonlinear terms, but rather it's the statement that a well-defined gauge-invariant question you could ask about the bulk, such as, you know, what is the metric at some point in the bulk, if you want to answer this question at all points in the CFT Hilbert space and not just in fluctuations about a given microstate, then that's a nonlinear CFT operator. So this is what, you know, state dependence means. And if you have this and you try and, you know, it would give you a violation of the Bond rule if you expected that this should be represented by a linear CFT operator. Okay. So I just want to say a little bit about a particular setting in which you can examine this very well, which is the thermofield double, which really makes all of these points clear. And I think it's an excellent laboratory for studying this issue of state dependence. It's a very, you know, it's a place where you can frame these paradoxes extremely sharply, and you also have intuition as to what the results should be. So in the thermofield, yes.
Is this the last point in your prepared remarks?
Yes, I'll finish in 3 minutes more. So give me 3 minutes. It's the last point in my prepared remarks. Okay. So consider, so let's say you take this thermofield double state, which is, you know, as you know, the state with entangled energy eigenstates and summed over all energy eigenstates, and you deform this thermofield double state by evolving it with the left Hamiltonian. Now, I think we understand fairly well from gravity that this is something that corresponds to a large diffeomorphism in the bulk. Okay? That's because evolution by the boundary Hamiltonian corresponds to a large diffeomorphism. And if you do this, then you know that the metric in the bulk is the same metric, although it's glued differently to the boundary. So in particular, you believe that the bulk geometry and all properties that are intrinsic to the bulk geometry that don't make relation to the left boundary are left invariant by this large diffeomorphism. In this set of states, in this set of one-parameter states labeled by this T, you could ask a well-defined conceptual question. What is the metric fluctuation seen by an observer who jumps in from some point in the right boundary and tries to measure the field at some point behind the horizon? And you can prove, in fact, that if you ask this question, then to describe this metric fluctuation in all of these time-shifted states, you necessarily require state-dependent observables. Okay, so this is something we can prove, and I can go into the details of the proof if you like, but it's something you can prove rather well. And what you find is that if you want to describe, you know, these observables about the original thermofield state and in fluctuations about the original thermofield state, then you can write down some precisely defined, you know, mode for this observable. But if you ask for the same observable in a state that's shifted exponentially away, you know, by an exponentially large time in ADS units from the original thermofield state, then you find that you need to use a different observable, and that corresponds to the cutoffs that you put here. So there is no single operator that in this one parameter family of states, you know, it's a Hilbert space, it's a subspace of the Hilbert space you can control very well. It's a one parameter family of states, and you can prove that there is no single operator that answers this conceptually well-defined question in all of these states. Let me just end very fast. Yeah, so let me just say a couple more things. Now, you can also understand why the canonical gravity intuition fails in the setup. The reason the canonical gravity intuition fails is because when you compute the inner product of this one-parameter family of states with the original thermofield double, you find that it has a fat tail. In particular, for very large t, it behaves as e to the minus s by 2. It has ergodic behavior, which is not seen by canonical gravity, which sees a fall-off which goes exponentially down and keeps falling off till ever, and therefore you have to put these cutoffs. So this fat tail is, you know, what indicates the breakdown of the canonical gravity intuition that I alluded to earlier. Okay, so that's basically all I have to say. I think it's a good setup where you can examine this intuition and also why the canonical gravity intuition fails and why you need state dependence. Let me just say there are a couple of alternatives which maybe Don will discuss, and there are alternatives. You could ask, you know, if you don't believe in state dependence in the thermofield double, what happens? And the alternatives are either that the eternal black hole also has firewalls, which contradicts some other calculations we can do that appear to suggest that the eternal black hole has a smooth interior. Or the other alternative, which I think is even more radical, is that ADS is not equal to CFT at all, and instead you have some superselection sectors that are required to describe the interior. And if you believe in these superselection sectors, then you get some other rather unusual predictions, such as the statement that even unentangled states could have a wormhole. So as far as I know, these are the only two alternatives you can set up here to state dependence, and it would be interesting to examine if any of these alternatives is palatable. One last thing about state dependence is that it's a sociological comment more than even a physics comment. which is that state dependence is something that we have seen a lot of, even though it's not been commented on as much. This entire conference where we had recently, where we discussed the relation of entanglement to geometry, is an example of a state-dependent formula. The moment you say that the area, some minimal area, is given by the entanglement entropy, you're writing down something that's state-dependent, because the area is also a linear observable within canonical gravity, the minimal area, whereas the entanglement entropy, as you can easily prove, is not the expectation value of any linear operator. And very similar comments apply to, you know, all notions such as ER equals CPR, or complexity and geometry, and all of these notions, all of which are also state dependent. So this will also help in explaining what state dependence really is. Okay, so I'll stop there.
So I would have, on this slide here, I would have said something else.
Yes.
Which is, I would have said the Ryutaki-Inagi formula is only valid for states that involve a single classical bulk metric and not states that involve a quantum superposition of different ones. So I would have thought that's just this
which
formula
in high,
isn't always true
it,
in all states.
It would be that the formula is not always true, although at high energies, almost all states correspond to a single classical metric outside. So if you look at high energy, you know, high energy states of the CFT, a generic high energy state corresponds to a black hole metric. And therefore, at high energies, this formula is, you know, presumably in that situation true for almost all states. Now, it could be, as you said, that the Ryutaki-Inagi formula is wrong. And what you really need to find here is some other operator that's equal to the area operator. So the Ryutaki-Inagi formula, I'm not saying is a proof of state dependence. It could just be a wrong formula that happens to be correct in some situations. I'm giving it as an example of a formula that, if you take seriously, is a state-dependent formula.
So do we really take it? Do we actually think that this is a true equation?
I'm not sure. I think that's the question of, you know, what we really believe. It may or may not be a true. I don't actually have a strong opinion on whether it's something that you should take ultimately seriously or not. But I think it's an excellent example for bringing out what state dependence means. This is an example of something that's state dependent. Now you may say that this formula is wrong. So interpret this formula as an example of something that's state dependent. I don't want to argue about, you know, whether Ryutaki-Inagi is correct or not. It's an example of a state dependent formula, which may or may not be right.
So no. If this were correct in a way that we're not state dependent, would you feel less confident about the rest of your talk?
I don't want to get into the intricacies of whether the Ryutaki-Inagi formula is correct or wrong. I just want to say that here's an example of something that explains very clearly what we mean by state dependence. We have something that looks like it's a linear operator in canonical gravity. We have something on the other side that's clearly a state-dependent operator. This is the quintessential example of state dependence. Now, whether this is wrong or right is a separate issue. Maybe it's wrong. Okay? And if it's wrong, I think we need to understand much better why it's wrong and why all such relations, such as, you know, deriving the metric using the modular Hamiltonian, writing down areas modular Hamiltonian, all such relations are wrong. And it could be that they're wrong. But they're quintessential examples of state dependence. That's all I want to say here.
How important, if at all, is the fact that the dual has a CFT structure to construct this mirror operator? For example, if it was dual to some matrix quantum mechanics where you don't have this field theory structure and you haven't said eigenvalues moving around, is it also supposed to be state-dependent if I heat up some D0 brains and I look inside?
If you look inside...
Yeah, so
inside
can you construct the analogous operators?
Yeah, it probably would be, but I mean, it's something, I mean...
Having a dual field theory or that type of structure is not important to this.
You know, in some sense, what you need is some structure of locality in the bulk, and you need to be able to set up these AMPS as paradoxes. As I said, the state dependence really comes from being able to set up the AMPS as paradoxes, which I think would apply to that setup of T0 brains. So it would be a question you could ask about the matrix model that would,
So would you agree, Subrat, that there's a, you don't exactly have a like totally precise formulation of these ideas, but isn't there a just as consistent formulation of these ideas where there's always a firewall when you jump in?
Yeah, so I think a good setting where you could examine that is the situation of the eternal black hole. So I think that brings us back to these alternatives. So it's true, there's a consistent alternative to these ideas, which is that you could say that instead of having state dependence, the eternal black hole has a firewall, or EDS is not equal to CFT.
But I don't even that. I mean, I include state dependent. I mean, I'm just saying in your formalism, I could just change a few of your definitions, and so that instead of creating no firewall states, you create firewall
I don't think that's that. So in the case of the eternal, so let's start with the assumption
you're just
that
putting in what you want.
Yes,
right?
Yes, I understand.
To.
But no, yes. But the issue is if you believe that the eternal black hole has a smooth interior, you do whatever calculations you've done, including say entanglement calculations on the two sides, and now you want to describe fluctuations of that smooth interior. Then the only way to do that in the eternal black hole and in all these time-shifted states is by using state-dependent operators. Now, so the only way if you start with the physical assumption, which I think is a reasonable assumption, that the eternal black hole is a smooth geometry, then the only way to describe those fluctuations is by means of using state-dependent operators. I think that's the statement.
Let me go through some other questions.
Does your construction of a smooth interior rely on n being large, and if so, can you see that go away when you take n to be finite?
Yeah, I think n being large is probably extremely important for everything we do. Everything is done at leading order in 1 over n. If you start taking n finite, where even e to the minus n square collections are important, then that's something that's a much harder situation to deal with.
A question. So besides the eternal black hole case, is there an explicit model or even a toy model where these mirror operators you can write down?
You can write down the mirror operators very easily because there's a precise prescription for them. So even if you took a spin chain, you could write down the mirror operators explicitly. So the mirror operators are just evolved by solving for that S operator I mentioned. So there's a formula I wrote down. So you can write down that S map, and given a particular state, you can write down a Mathematica script, which is, I think, in one of our papers, which will generate these mirror operators for you in the spin chain. The thing is that in any other setting, in, say, even the single-sided black hole, you could say, why are these the correct operators to use? Because you might say that generic black holes have firewalls, and you're using state dependence as opposed to firewalls, and I like firewalls better than state dependence, so why shouldn't I choose firewalls over state dependence? So by taking you to the eternal black hole, I'm trying to come up with a situation where hopefully all of us agree that we don't have firewalls, and therefore I'm arguing that you need, if you believe that the eternal black hole is smooth, you need state dependent operators to describe its interior. I think the eternal black hole is a good case to focus on for that reason.
I had a question about the next slide.
This one? I know. Yeah, maybe I shouldn't have put it in. Yeah.
On the left-hand side, we know that the next order in 1 over n, the left-hand side is no longer state. State. Or is no longer linear because it involves the bulk
of
entropy. So.
Okay, but this is a leading order formula. So the question is, I'm not sure you'd be able to fix that. The fact that there's some 1 over n corrections, I don't think that would fix the fact that this is, the leading order is something that's state dependent.
Oh.
There's just, I've certainly not seen any such, it would seem very unusual. You could fix the leading order state dependence by some 1 over n.
But if there's no real operator that exists on the left-hand side, then...
Oh, but there is a real operator that exists in canonical gravity on the left-hand side, which is the area. So if you believe that this formula is correct to leading order 1 by n, then you have something that's a state-dependent observable on the right and something that's...
Okay.
That's
All right, one more question, and then we need to move on.
I was wondering if there's some calculation that could maybe start to derive these kinds of formulas you're proposing. Clearly, operators in the interior, it's hard to evolve them back. But if you would take a black hole that formed recently, you could actually evolve back those operators in the interior.
Yes.
Back through the shell of matter that made the black hole.
Yes.
So, and then you could get kind of an explicit formula for
what
these operators are.
I think what you would get there would be anything you could do within effective field theory is something you would do within the little Hilbert space. So I think within that setup, within a given microstate, if you evolve the operators backwards, you would be able to write down an explicit formula, which I think would be the correct linear operator to use in the little Hilbert space, which describes evolution of that microstate. To some limited amount
of
time.
Yeah, but would it be equal to your formula?
I think so. Well, okay, so that's our formula is designed to reproduce semi-classical effective field theory in the bulk. It's something we put in. So by construction, I think it would be equal to that to the formula that we, if you worked in the little Hilbert space. To really see the state dependence, you have to somehow go beyond effective field theory, and I don't know that there's any way to do that independently in the bulk.
Okay. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Comments, and particularly because I know that Supra would begin to try to indicate some of the ways in which the proposal that I discussed with Vernon actually it's a way of approaching, attacking the Higgs paradox, different from the our proposal. Actually, our point of view is not even that we have solved it entirely. It's really a challenge to avoid firewalls and avoid this state dependence. So let me start by mentioning some points which I think are not so appreciated about the whole situation. First of all, what is a black hole state? Sometimes it's said that it's a typical state which has an energy of the order of, say, the black hole mass. This is not the correct way of thinking about it. Also, it's not even if you add to it, if you say all the correlators would be thermal. Because there are many states that have thermal correlators which may not be black hole states. And also some of the linearity properties that are assumed about black hole states are not always true. So what is it? There's certainly an equilibrium condition, which is the one that Suprat and Kyriakos used. But it actually is not just this condition that we have thermal correlation function. Actually, it makes use of it. For this, you have to have knowledge about the microscopic microscopic Hamiltonian. And this is where the proposal that Roman and I had actually differs from what was discussed before. So it's not just sufficient to say it's thermal correlation functions or to think about typical states. So let me try to make more clear what in what way we're thinking about it. If you think about ADS CFD, first you have to understand what a vacuum state looks like. And certainly in recent times we're discussing much more about the bulk perspective, where we try to represent degrees of freedom in the bulk as highly entangled, and we have the sort of mirror picture. So if you think about the state in the microscopic Hilbert space, first if we start from the vacuum, this is a highly entangled state with an entanglement entropy, as we have now heard many times, sort of given by A over 4G. While even this is just a unique state, apparently we have an entanglement entropy, so there are many qubits sort of that are involved in here, which are in their ground state, in very one particular state. And that's quite important in trying to describe the bulk perspective. So you have to add many more qubits than just the ones that you see in your story. Now, if you want to go to a black hole has lots of states associated to them, but where do they live? So the state that describes the entangled ground state, for instance, does not have any quantum field theory models in the bulk. So I would like to factor out anything that we have in terms of a quantum field theory, because these are like simple single trace operators, and they satisfy, for instance, large N factorization. And but the black hole states actually are not described by any of this. It's a complicated state, which is an entangled state in this entire Hilbert space. And it's a state with a very particular form of entanglement. So what I want to do is actually think about now a subspace in here, which is the black hole states. And I'm going to think about this actually very much by thinking about the state, the vacuum state, as a sort of tensor network. So if I would indeed think about the picture that Daniel and his collaborators, the happy people, have indicated. So we have some tensor network, and then if we have in the vacuum, then this is one particular tensor network without any degrees of freedom into it. But you can add states to it, which you can encode in this space. And then you're encoding degrees of freedom over an entire large region in such a way there's no way of locally measuring it. And then if you have this, for instance, in a region of size R, the states that you put in here, the maximum number of states, should be no larger than what you can have in terms of this entanglement. And then you fulfilled this code space. So that the space that is even the CFD Hilbert space is the Hilbert space in which you maximally use all of these degrees of freedom, and they're n squared per ABS radius. But these are all unconfined degrees of freedom where you could use the entire n squared of your CFD. But the quantum field theory nodes, they are very special nodes which are localized, and they describe the local operators, and they form a very tiny part, and they hardly contribute even to the entanglement across the surface. So you should not even worry so much about what's happening here. Most of the stuff is happening here. And if you make a black hole, you make it here. Because you start encoding the qubits in a region of size R, in modes that have a range of size R, and then you have a code subspace protected in this entire picture. And now you want to know how what kind of states these are. And they're very entangled states between here and here. And so what we showed actually is that if you think about the microscopic Hamiltonian, you can actually understand the entanglement structure of these states. So because these states are entangled states where the quantum field theory states and these states are entangled with each other in a very particular way. Not in a generic way, and you're not allowed to do any phase rotations in here. There's a very particular way in which if you write a state.
This HQFT, those are like quantum field theory excitations in the bulk outside the horizon.
Outside.
That's what they are.
And so they are representable in terms of simple single phase operators.
And H micro is the states of the black hole itself.
Black hole, not the entire, but you should not think about them in the interior because they're actually network states that even go outside. And they describe a certain region in the vicinity of the black hole, size 1 over R. And these states here are encoded in a very complicated way where you have no idea where they are and they're very difficult to get up. However, if you have excitations which have the same size of your black hole, they may couple to them. And so there is an interaction Hamiltonian that couples the code space to the quantum field theory, although mostly you cannot see the code in the subspace. Local perturbations don't see them. So you need to know the interaction Hamiltonian between these states. And this is where the equilibrium condition will come in. So when you then write down the equilibrium condition of what this state looks like, it has a very particular form. It has certain operators that create if I take the operators that create modes in the CFD, and here I can take the same set of algebra that Schubert and Kyriakos talked about. So I look in my Hilbert space here. I have a microscopic state, but there's also a vacuum state of the quantum field theory. And here we can think about starting with some basis state in here. And then this is actually achieved by relaxing the system using the interaction Hamiltonian. So you can ask, if I start from this state, clearly it's not a vacuum, not a black hole state. But you just let it evolve using the interaction Hamiltonian. After some time, you reach this equilibrium state. And it has a very particular structure where these operators are entirely determined by your microscopic Hamiltonian. And then in terms of these operators, you can reconstruct the interior operators. And if you look for this state, it actually is the same proposal that Schubert and Kyriakos talked about, except it's not the most generic state, though it's not these states that we apply proposals to. They're states that have reached a certain equilibrium given the microscopic Hamiltonian, and then these coefficients are not just arbitrary coefficients that you can rotate in part to phase rotation from. They're operators that are constructed out of the microscopic Hamiltonian. Now, how good can we do then the reconstruction of the interior? That depends indeed on what is the size of the code space in the entire Hilbert space. If this Hilbert space is large, you can reconstruct the interior. And the question is, how large is this microscopic Hilbert space? And this is one of the lessons you can learn. You can avoid background dependence or state dependence, but this is a large enough. So maybe we need a large Hilbert space in the CFD to be able to do this. but I don't know exactly. So this is where I don't know where I, but there is a reconstruction of these operators. And we have actually quite an explicit form of the creation operators on the other side, and actually it was very similar to what Suprat wrote down. If you know the two-point function of these operators in the state, say, psi 0, this defines some normalizations. They are orthogonal. And then by dividing by the square root of this W in here, which is sort of like what you do with a moral Hamiltonian, you construct operators that exactly obey those equations that you would like to have for the interior observer. And you can do this very well as long as the algebra that you're trying to reconstruct and the size of the code space is small enough so that you have enough space in this code space. I'm not going to go into the details of this construction, but there is a construction that does not depend on the background, does not depend on the state, because this is partly what you're doing, error correction. You try to reconstruct the interior state. So what do you do in error correction? You get exactly this situation that if you emit some particles outside, which is sort of what the interaction Hamiltonian does, it creates some state in the form of field theory. And your problem is to find with what state that is entangled in the interior. And there's a protocol to do this, which doesn't require the knowledge of the state to begin with. Simply can do it for every state. And that gives you a state-independent reconstruction of these operators. Except the question is, can you do it well enough so that you can do it on the entire Hilbert space of the black hole, yes or no? And there are some inequalities that you have to be careful about, but it depends also on how large the actual microscopic Hilbert space is. This is a statement that we have. We don't propose it as a solution, but it's a different statement about background dependence than there was a supervisor. Yeah, it's a sort of what I would say.
Thank you.
So I just want to clarify, you mentioned at some point that perhaps your microscopic Hilbert space was bigger than that of the dual CFT. So I want to understand, when you said that for you the black hole states, which are taken as the states of this code subspace, are not typical, do you mean that your code subspace is necessarily small compared to, say, this space of the fixed energy in the CFT?
Well, not necessarily, because I mean this contains particles, black holes also with particles around it. If you count all of those states, still has an entropy roughly that of the black hole entropy. But including them in the definition of the black hole would be wrong, because then you're including precisely the states that you're trying to recover with your operator. So the quantum field theory is a very small perturbation on the actual thing that happens here. I mean, in the entanglement entropy hardly contributed, even in the construction of the Hilbert space, it hardly contributed. But including it in the picture would give you wrong ideas. So you have to know that the states that are describing really smooth horizon black holes are indeed a special subset of those states.
Let me clarify. They're small and they're small. I agree, of course, that if you compute correctly to the entropy coming from the quantum outside the black hole, then as long as your ultraviolet cutoff near the horizon is not too small, it's a small correction. However, if I let that ultraviolet cutoff be reasonably small, okay, I will still come to the conclusion that although I'm correcting the entropy only by some order one amount, I'm correcting the size of the Hilbert space, the dimension of the Hilbert space, by a large number.
Well,
so that, for example...
It's the same thing that we would write down here, where we would renormalize Newton's constant and so on. So that cannot be... So I'm claiming indeed that in order to get vacuum contributions, of course the quantum field theory has an entanglement as well, but although the entanglement now is in between this one and the inside.
So just to be precise, I think you're telling me, which I would agree with, that say at large N and large E, the proportion of states in the Hilbert space at fixed energy, which really behave like the black hole in the Hartle-Hawking vacuum state, is no more than, you know, 1/1,000,000 or 1/1,000,000,000 or some tiny fraction.
Yes.
Great.
If that's the statement that most states apply about.
most of this, so here I have written down my state, and this state I can change by acting with operators here. Mm-hmm. Most of them look like firewalls. But in the quantum field theory, it's still quite a small Hilbert space compared to the entire Hilbert space that I've been looking at. And this entanglement that we talked about here is exactly the entanglement that I'm writing down here in this state. But I'm claiming this is the entanglement of the vacuum, and I'm not allowing all the states to be written down here that would create particles. So there is a larger Hilbert space, which I would not call black hole states, and that's because they don't satisfy this condition, and they're not equilibrium states. You find in terms of the interaction Hamiltonian between this vector and that vector.
Don't most states reach equilibrium after evolution by a long time, even by this definition?
They will eventually reach equilibrium, and I think that must be related to some scrambling.
But if that's the case, and you have a fixed set of states in the macroeconomical ensemble, and if long-term evolution takes most states to equilibrium states.
No, actually, to be honest, I think this step is a little tricky, because you might conclude from here that I can make a linear space here appear to a linear space of equilibrium states. I don't think that's true. And this is the reason is that this is actually unitary, and therefore we should really kill some of the off diagonal nodes. So the equilibrium states are basically not linear. I mean, there's a certain set of states that you have to write down.
Yeah, okay. They're not a linear space, but is it just true that if you take the Haar measure and the microeconomical ensemble, and you pick a state, and you wait for as long a time as you like,
yes,
aren't most states equilibrium states by that measure?
Well, but that means you form black holes which are maybe larger. I mean, there's a certain way in which Hilbert space are we looking at a large black hole or a smaller black hole. It's clear that only a subspace of the states is the smooth horizon states. It's not the full. The main point is that the coefficients that we have here, we don't have the right to start putting phases in here if you think about that still as a typical equilibrium state, because these coefficients are very precisely determined by the macroscopic Hamiltonian. And so there is certainly a restriction that you have to put on this state.
Is it important that your initial state was sort of ADS plus some imploding matter or something?
What we envisioned here was that we supposed we first switch off the interaction Hamiltonian between this part and that part. And we look at a state which has just no particle on the outside of the black hole. This is, of course, a singular state because it would not.
But does it have a black hole at all, is what I'm asking.
Sorry, it has a set of states. It has a phase, I mean, a set of states that we put in the microscopic Hilbert space, which are not described by quantum field theory nodes outside of the black hole. If you know that the interaction Hamiltonian couples the two, so you just have to wait, and then it will start emitting these particles, and it will build up an equilibrium, and that equilibrium state is the one we're looking at here. And it may involve actually letting some of those particles escape to infinity, so it's not process that you might think about as really a linear method. It's really just letting the black hole equilibrium.
It sounds like you're saying that the generic initial state would sort of have a firewall, but it would be healed by equilibration.
That's correct.
It seems more natural to say the small subspace that you want to start with is the states that have a smooth ADS to begin with, and you form a black hole, starting with a smooth space-time, and okay, then say only that subspace of states
I understand.
Are expected to have a smooth
horizon. The reason why we needed this is that what you need to know is what operator do I need to act with if I want to admit another particle. And this is a transition amplitude that's determined by the interaction Hamiltonian, the usual way to do this in atomic physics. So we have to have this state there, and we have to know what are the transition amplitudes. And this is how you build your creation and annihilation operator. So you have to have, I mean, in the quantum computing language, it's the quantum computer has to be there, and you have to be able to see how it interacts with its environment. And then you can reconstruct what state it's entangled with. So this is what we did over here. And actually, this is the equations we use are basically copied from the textbooks on quantum computing, because they use exactly the same methods to do the error correction.
A related question. Can I really think the macro states and the QFT as direct product of each other? Because naively, I can take low energy operators and create many low energy excitations, then the energy is high enough to
Yeah, so this separation, of course, is similar to what Sufa talked about. You have to allow certain operators here, and you have to allow not too many things to be active.
That's what I mean, that the Hilbert space doesn't look like a product of the two. Because the algebra that acts on QFT doesn't form an algebra.
Well,
it cannot multiply them many times.
Yeah, maybe I should say it as follows. These states are the ones that use the full n squared degrees of freedom of the CFT, and they are really states that have used the gauge, full non-Abelian gauge part of it. These are states that are short trace operators, and they are very simple, and they have very large n factorization. In that way, I can try to, at large n, think about a separation of these two Hilbert spaces, because they're even distinguished by the way they carry their entanglement entropy. This entanglement entropy goes like A over 4G. This state can never contribute that much. So it's really the small subspace that we're trying to describe.
So basically, I can think like the QFT Hilbert space is a subspace rather than a factor space.
Yeah.
And the other one is like whatever perpendicular.
Okay, so in that sense, I think this step, I must say, I wish I could do it slightly differently. I mean, there must be some more precise way, and maybe along the way that Sufa can react with it.
If I could ask, when you talk about equilibration, that was a unitary process?
That's a good question, and I don't think it actually is. So I don't think that I can make a one-to-one map from here to all of those states here, because this is where indeed you probably can start to build arguments where things can go.
So if I had just a black hole sitting in ADS space running under its own intrinsic Hamiltonian, does it equilibrate in your sense?
Yes, I do think it does. Of course, it starts becoming. So the question is whether we can have the Hawking radiation coming out.
Yeah.
And we wait long enough so that it starts building an equilibrium state with its whole radiation.
But why isn't that evolution unitary?
It is, but I think if you take this linear map too seriously, you start tinkering with all the phases in here, so that eventually it evolves into something else. Just by the trick, well, you want me to know what state it is, and I evolve backwards. So unitary evolution does not automatically give you... I mean, if I take this state, I have to wait that much time. I can always make an initial state that after that much time would not be an equilibrium state, namely by just evolving backward.
Yes.
So the question is, how long do you have to wait before this equilibrates? And this is actually where I think the map becomes sort of non-linear, because you have to, for different states, you have to wait different amounts of time.
No, but I was worried about Subrat's question a while ago, which is a state campaign question, that it seems difficult to take a Hilbert space, which is large, and to claim that it equilibrates via a unitary process into a space with smaller dimension.
What's happening here. So this Hilbert space is not, should not be, you're right, it's important that we do this in a Hilbert space that eventually is larger than the one we start from.
Right.
That's true.
But it looks like there are two things which I mentioned. One of them is the Hamiltonian evolution leads to equilibrium states, and the other is that equilibrium states are a small subset of the Hilbert space. It looks like those two things are intentional.
That is true, but I think that's part of the definition of the Pauli equilibrium state. I think if I think about it more in physical terms, I think I know what we mean here, but I think if you write me, ask me to write it operationally, I probably cannot.
Okay, that's a good time to move on to the next speaker.
I'm just going to review some arguments from a paper I wrote last year, so none of this is particularly new, but I think maybe hasn't been fully appreciated, so I'll try again. So I think, in my experience, most of the confusion in discussions about state-dependent operators arises from the fact that the term has never been defined. And its proponents use it to mean different things in different situations. And I mean, as do other people, because nobody really knows what it means. So I claim that we would all be better served by instead discussing the following, hopefully more precise question, which is the measurement process described by unitary evolution on the system being measured and the measuring apparatus. Okay? I think that's a question which I think is reasonably sharp. And clearly, in quantum mechanics, we think the answer is yes. And my goal today is to convince you or explain to you how, even in situations which naively seem state-dependent in a sort of colloquial sense of the term, the measurement theory is still described by linear unitary evolution on the system coupled to the apparatus. So I hope then that will also convince you that any theory or attempts to make a theory where the answer to the question is no is going beyond quantum mechanics, which doesn't mean that it's wrong, okay? I mean, I actually personally think that to understand the black hole interior properly, we are in some sense going to need to modify quantum mechanics. But we can't just do it cavalierly or casually. I mean, you know, the history of theoretical physics is littered with the refuse of people who are trying to modify quantum mechanics. So we should do it. We should be completely clear about what we're doing. Okay, we should be honest. Even though in this case, you know, maybe I'm sympathetic to it, and you know, maybe that means I'm going to be, you know, some of the refuse later. But you know, one way to at least try and avoid that is to be precise about what you're doing. Now, to explain this, you know, I only have, you know, a short amount of time, so I'm just going to talk about one model, which I think clearly illustrates most of the discussion that's come up about state dependence. And the model is just going to be Goldstone bosons. So, you know, I'm going to have some quantum field theory. You know, some ON model, so phi is some scalar field with an internal ON index. You know, I can write the Lagrangian, minus G over 4. Okay, that's a theory I guess we all know about. M squared is positive. So this theory has spontaneous symmetry breaking. We can label the vacua by a unit vector pointing in the phi space. So let's say there's n of these phi's, so this is a unit vector, mRn. To leading order in G, G being the coupling here, in any one of these states, we have some expectation value for phi. Okay. That at least is hopefully not controversial. So the spectrum of this theory is that there are n minus 1 Goldstone bosons and 1 massive scalar with mass, I don't know, equals 2m squared. Mass squared equals 2m squared. Right? And that's the radial piece of phi. Now, why am I talking about this model? Well, the reason is because the field that creates the Goldstone bosons, which I'll call sort of phi perp, it looks state dependent, right? So you, you know, if you just write it out naively, okay, it looks like that. So you've just sort of projected out the radial piece of phi, and then you want the orthogonal piece. You know, if this is all we meant by state-dependent operators, I mean, come on, that's clearly going to be fine, right? I mean, this is just Goldstone bosons. So what I want to do is I want to explain to you sort of in more detail why this is fine and why this does not constitute a nonlinear modification of quantum mechanics, which I shouldn't have to explain to you, but given all the confusion after, it, you know, 2 years of this, I think it's worth explaining it in detail. In order to really know what we're doing, we have to say a little bit more, you know, we have to say more carefully, you know, how actually do we mean, what are we doing when we measure the gold, you know, say the two-point function of the Goldstone boson field. And there's actually three different, you know, three inequivalent things that have been proposed either in the literature or in private discussions, and I'm going to tell you all of them because people keep bringing them up and conflating them, and then that leads to further confusion. So I want to clearly emphasize that they're all different. So option number one. So you define the n hat operator to just be the, you know, the zero mode of the field. Okay, so this is the volume of space-time. I'm going to be working in finite volumes so that everything is well-defined. I mean, otherwise, these are different states. These states aren't in the same Hilbert space. So this is the volume. And so I average the field over the volume, and then I rescale by this factor here to get something that's a unit factor. So this is an operator. It's a linear operator on the Hilbert space. And so then the first thing that we could do...
You're working in finite volume.
Yeah.
But you're considering states which are supposedly vacuum states, and they're not vacuum states.
Good. That's correct. So there will be splittings which are suppressed by powers of the volume here. So we have to say now a little bit more carefully what we mean by these states. I'm just going to define them as eigenvectors of this operator.
But the true vacuum is
the true vacuum
just
is not
a superposition
of that. That's correct. The true vacuum is a symmetric superposition. But as soon as you put in the smallest symmetry breaking perturbation, it's going to the system is going to split so that right. I mean, just the usual thing you always say about spontaneous symmetry breaking. But I think for the purposes of this discussion, it's good enough to just define them as the eigenvectors of this operator. Okay. Now, so certainly one thing we can do is we can just measure.
But there is a zero. I mean, there is a problem, a symmetric state.
What?
What are the arguments?
I mean, this is an operator, right? This is the zero mode of the field. And it's a Hermitian operator. I can diagonalize it. I agree that I won't get exact eigenstates of the Hamiltonian when I do that. But I don't think that's an issue for the purposes of this discussion. I'll get something that is very close to eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. You have to put in some, the fluctuations are very small when the volume is large. So the first thing we can do, is we can define an operator where I just put n hat operator here. Okay. So this is what Joe likes. This is what sometimes called...
No, I don't like it here.
Background dependence. I'm not going to... Well, it's a thing you seem to do, right?
Okay, but I wasn't liking this when you said that. So.
This is field dependence,
right?
This is field dependence. Yeah. So this is a linear operator on the Hilbert space. Now do you like it? And I could imagine measuring it. Okay?
I don't know what that means. To define phi in terms of phi.
No. So phi is well defined. Okay, phi is well defined, and this is defined in terms of phi. And now I can stick this into the right hand side of this equation, and that defines an operator. That's well defined.
Which is a highly nonlinear.
Which is a very non-local operator because it has. So this is a non-local operator. Mm-hmm. So it's not a local operator. But in a limit of large volume, it's almost a local operator because the commutator of phi with n hat operator goes like one over the volume.
I will explain after your 10 minutes why I don't like this. Maybe you'll explain it for me.
Well, I mean, this isn't my favorite resolution either. I just wanted to present it because it's often discussed, including by you, in other contexts. Yeah, I think this is the analog of what you like to do in the ball.
No.
Yeah, we can discuss it after this sentence. Okay. So this is one thing you could imagine doing. This is certainly a thing that's allowed by quantum mechanics. I could measure this operator, and its correlation functions in this state would be very close to the ones where had I just, in this state, stuck in this operator with this C number.
Just to warn you, it is the 10 minutes. So.
My talk will still be shorter than Eric's. So now proposal number two, and I'm presenting. My favorite proposal is proposal number three. All of these are
proposal for what? A definition?
For a thing you can do in this system. One thing you can do in this system is you can measure this operator, and that's described by unitary evolution on the pointer coupled to the quantum field. maybe I should have said that explicitly. If you interpret this as measuring this, then the answer to my question is yes. It's described by unitary evolution. Now, another formula that people like to write is they say, oh no, what you should do instead is you should measure this thing where you take phi perp of x and n hat, now again it's a C number, and you sandwich it between projection operators onto subspaces of definite n hat, and then you sum. So this is another thing that people like to say. And again, this is a well-defined operator on the Hilbert space. You could measure it in the same way that you can measure any linear Hermitian operator, and you'll get some answer. Notice the answer will be different than what you got from measuring this, though. They'll differ at the level of the 1 over volume corrections, okay? So I hope that emphasizes it clearly to you that these are two different things. Now, my favorite proposal, though, is actually number 3, because these are actually rather silly. I mean, this is an extremely non-local operator, and this is also an extremely non-local operator. And when you're just playing in your lab, you know, you got a table and you're measuring the phonons, you don't want to build an apparatus that's every single time you do that is prepared to diagnose the zero mode of the system, okay? So my claim for what we actually do in this situation is that you first measure n op once, okay? Find the table. Once you've done that, then conditioned on the result, which I'll call n hat real, which is a C number, it's the result of you got the experiment you got by measuring n the operator, then measure phi perp of x and n real. Okay? I claim that's what we do.
Isn't that like projecting?
No. So let me emphasize very much that this is not like projecting. This is two successive measurements. It's a thing you can do in quantum mechanics, but it cannot be described by a single projection operator. Okay? And this follows from the standard fact that the product of two projection operators is not a projection operator unless they commute. Okay?
If the different if something was orthogonal, then it would be equivalent, right?
Yeah, so if they exactly commuted, but that was part of why I wanted to be in finite volume, was to emphasize that these are different things.
The possible eigenstates are orthogonal, right? Because they're the eigenstates of a...
The eigenstates are orthogonal, but these different, like, phi doesn't commute with this n hat, right? I mean, I think this is really a physically different thing, right? To do this, I need two detectors. I have the detector where I write down the result of measuring n up, and then I look at that detector, and then based on that, I measure this thing, and I write it down on another detector. It's a different physical thing than just having one detector. What?
You learn more information.
You learn more information.
1 and 2 are just trying to measure one thing.
Yeah, that's right. So it's really a different thing. And I want to emphasize that one of the important things to learn here is that there's more to measurement theory and quantum mechanics than just measuring one linear operator.
So is the measurement going to project it onto the eigenvalue of m?
Yes, so the first measurement will do that. Right, because of the usual drop to the wave function, if you want to say it that way. The last thing I'm going to say, though, is I'm going to explain to you how this is still unitary evolution on the joint system.
But is the first measurement measuring all the components? But they don't commute, right? So which component are they
first?
The different components of this, yes, they do.
They commute.
Yeah, there's no phi dots in there. Okay. Now, it's clear that at the level of 1 over v corrections, this is going to be different than the other two things, right? For example, because you'll measure this, and then you'll measure these for a while, but then because these don't really commute with that at the level of 1 over v corrections, it won't stay measured, right? And then in principle, after a while, you have to measure it again.
Yeah, of course, we tend to work in infinite volume. Isn't this obviously what infinite volume tells you to do?
Yes. Yes. No. I want it to be in finite volume, just to be clear that these really are.
Just,
you know,
to have.
To me, logically, it's clear that
just to have options.
Yeah. 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 Just
because infinite volume. That's.
Well, I don't know. I mean, the table isn't really infinite.
Infinite volume 2 and 3 are the same, right?
No, they're not.
No.
No, they're not. No, they're definitely not. They're physically different things. You have more detectors here than you have there.
In infinite volume, you have super selection. So
good, that's right, yeah.
And measuring or is the same as choosing.
Yeah, that's right.
In your finite time, are you going to give an example of something that's not okay? Because these are all okay.
I'm about to, but yeah. Well, I'm trying.
4 minutes left in this room.
That's okay, but we've been having a discussion. Okay, so this is easy. I think this is what we do. Let me just comment, because it's maybe not obvious to all of you, that this is totally unitary. So the way this works, right, so it's a standard fact in quantum mechanics that if I have a bipartite system, say I'm a, then, and so this is some complete basis, then if I consider the thing where I do this transformation, where this is any collection whatsoever of U sub i's, this is a unitary transformation. Okay, this is called conditioned unitary evolution, and it's a unitary transformation on the whole thing. Okay, and then now that makes it obvious that this is unitary, right? Because, you know, you combine this with, so the standard measurement protocol, right, is, you know, I have some pointer which starts out initialized in zero, and then I have here some eigenstate of the thing I'm measuring, and then this goes to I on the pointer. So that's also a unitary transformation. So then what I do is, you know, I first measure this and write the result onto a pointer using this unitary transformation. Then I take that pointer and I use that as this thing here, and then I apply again the measuring unitary now on the second pointer together with the original, with the system being measured, and it's obviously unitary. Okay, so this still passes the test. Yes, this answered the question. In fact, you know, I claim that all the sort of naive state dependence that is sometimes, I think, incorrectly used to motivate various things is actually of this type. Everything that we encounter in the real world, you know, doing atomic physics, doing particle physics, we're always doing something like this. Okay.
But this is only linear evolution of the system plus the
apparatus. That's right. Yeah. Okay, good. So now let me contrast this with what is advocated sometimes in the context of black hole physics. And again, I mean, you know, although, you know, maybe my tone is obnoxious, I don't mean to dismiss this. I just want to differentiate it from this, okay? So here's the kind of thing that people would like to have. So I throw in my apparatus into, you know, say it could be into the black hole, but let's just say I couple my apparatus to some system in some way, okay? And now what I want is, if the system starts out in state psi 1, then we measure some operator O1. And whereas if the system starts out in Psi2, then we measure some O2, which is not equal to O1. And now that's still fine. I mean, Psi1 and Psi2 could be orthogonal quantum states. And so I can certainly define a unitary which, you know, acting on this state, you know, does something like this, and acting on this state does something else. But what's now additionally required or advocated is that if I take Psi1 plus Psi2 and I throw in the same apparatus, okay, then now I measure O3, which is neither equal to O2 nor to O1.
Is that referring to a specific proposal?
Yes.
This doesn't happen in my case. You need superpositions of two states.
No, you need to take superpositions of more. But
exponentially, that's not.
No, that's incorrect. Actually, if you tell me the procedure for one equilibrium state, and then you tell me the procedure for another equilibrium state without knowing about the other one, and then I also hand you your superposition, you'll hand me yet a third operator.
Is a generic equivalence.
Yeah.
This is true.
No. I'm not letting you get to pick your operators after I tell you which two states I'm going to pick. You have to pick them separately for the two states. You know, just give me a list. For all the equilibrium states, give me your operators. Okay? And now after you've done that, then if I take that list and I just pick two of them and I do this, this will hold.
But this O3 is completely indistinguishable from O2 and O1. And it's
so the different operators in the Hilbert space.
But it's totally indistinguishable with an effective field theory.
But are you trying to do something
agree,
more?
You agree that I think you agree that that you would advocate this. Okay. So we agree. So let's not fight about it. Okay. But now then I think it should be clear that this is not going to be linear evolution on the system, right? Because once you specify what happens here and you specify what happens here, then if the evolution is linear, then you don't have a choice about what happens here.
Aren't you trying to do something more ambitious now? Because what you were trying to do in 3 is you only had some protocol that was defined on eigenstates of n.
No. This is defined on the whole Hilbert space. These are unitary transformations.
No, that's fine. But your first step was to, all you were trying to do was to define this phi perp around a basis of eigenstates.
I'm not saying this is equal to that. I'm saying it's different.
It seems to be trying to solve a more ambitious problem,
which
you were trying to solve in number 3.
Yeah, I'm just saying this is. I don't want this to seem weird. I find that it does seem weird when I try and explain to people, but I don't know why. To me, this is obvious.
No, that's a fine thing to do.
Yeah. So my point is just that we should not conflate this with that. Okay? If we wanted to try and make what they do sound more like this, then what we would have to say is you're sitting outside the black hole, and before you jump in, you first measure all the microstates. You measure the microstate. You know, you measure some complete set of commuting operators. And then after you've done that, conditioned on the result, then you decide how you're going to jump in. Okay? And I guess we could talk about it, but I mean, come on, that's not really the experiment most of us are interested in describing, right? I mean, I guess it would be nice to describe it. But I mean, the one we care about is the one where I give you the black hole, you may or may not know which one it is, you just jump in and see what happens without doing any sort of advanced planning. And that's the difference between these two here, right? This one had some advanced planning. So moreover, I would claim that, you know, this is also what's going on outside of the black hole. Okay? So for example, one of the things people like to say is, oh, when you look at Kvantlefshitz and Lowe outside the black hole, you know, there's some mass or something that appears in the formula. If I were actually going to, you know, swoop into the zone near the black hole and come back out, I'd probably first figure out how big the black hole was before I programmed the rockets on my spaceship. And then that would be like doing this protocol. So I think the point I would like to take away here is that when we talk about measuring things, what we should have in mind is a measurement protocol. Okay? We shouldn't just say, oh, there's some operator, and we're measuring that, you know, and assume that everyone knows what that means, right? Because we've seen here that, you know, different people come up with different set of words they like to say when confronted with that situation. So I think we really need to say, you know, in detail, what are we doing? And these kinds of proposals, I don't think so far have been defined at the level of precision that this protocol was defined. And maybe they will be, I don't know. Why don't I necessarily believe these things? It's because they haven't been derived from some actual theory of the measurement process. They've just sort of been made up to give us the answer that we want. That doesn't mean it's wrong. Maybe it is right. But, you know, it would be nice if it came out of something rather than just sort of being put in. Okay.
Thank you.
To plug in here. I'm going to allow my presentation to progress rapidly. Let's see how this works. Great. Yeah, excellent. Excellent, excellent.
Can you say you're not going
technology to is working. All right. So, let's see, there's a stick someplace to keep the crowd at bay. Good. So, Rob gave a lovely description of what state dependence is, and Dan made some comments about some of the implications. So, my purpose here today is not to pretend that I know what the physics of black holes really is and what happens when you fall into a horizon, but just to indicate quantitatively how large is the modification of quantum mechanics that Sovrat talked about. If you think it's going to be enough of an effect to render typical states at some energy, to make typical states at some energy look like black holes with smooth horizons. Okay. So if you're someone like Eric, who is happy for typical states, say in some ADS system dual to some CFT with some energy cutoff, if you're happy like Eric to have typical states not correspond to black holes with smooth horizons, but instead to have firewalls, then I have no qualms with diffusion. All right. So, let's proceed. I thought I'd write down my assumptions. As I implied, the context of my discussion today, just for concreteness, put black holes in a box and remove some thread issues, is going to discuss anti-de-Sitter Schwarzschild black holes. And I'm going to make three assumptions, which I wrote down here at some length. I guess I'll read them. Here we go. The first one is that, keyword here is typical. In typical pure quantum states with large fixed energy E naught, the experiences of infalling observers with high probability are governed by effective field theory in the Hartle-Hawking state on a classical black hole background. So that's assumption one. Assumption two is that when you do things in the quantum gravity system here, if you can describe it in terms of operators living at the ADS boundary, those are free of the state-dependent effects that Sovrat talked about, and they're nice, normal, linear quantum operators on some Hilbert space. This assumption is strongly motivated by, for example, ADS CFT. Assumption three is that I have some control over the density of states in the theory, and let's say it's given by the Beckenstein-Hawking amount, although that detail is not particularly critical. It's useful to make things quantitative. Good. These are my three assumptions. The asterisk here is that what do I mean by typical? I believe, like Sovrat, I'm going to mean as defined by the round measure on the unit sphere in Hilbert space. So again,
the unit CPM.
The round measure.
Different from the Haar measure?
It's the same as the Haar measure, but I thought I wouldn't say Haar, because I'm supposed to be talking to the uninitiated. And, you know, a sphere is obviously round. It takes an extra step to talk about the Haar measure on the unitary group. So, it's the same measure. It's the same measure, right? There's a, and I should have said CPN-1, okay? But the point is, of course, that there's a Hilbert space, which, if I'm at finite energy in a system with no infrared issues, there should be a finite-dimensional Hilbert space. That means, but of course, physical states are really defined by rays in that Hilbert space, so there's some, you know, compact space, which is the unit sphere modulo a phase. Okay. If you have any issues with the three assumptions here, please save them for later, but we're going to proceed. And my point is simply to show that with these three assumptions, you immediately, well, you arrive rather quickly at large violations of the usual Born rule of quantum mechanics, and also a sense in which these large violations can be observed. So I just want to make that explicit. Okay, so how does this go? The key point in this discussion is that if physics around these black holes is described by effective field theory, there's an enormous redshift at the horizon that allows large excitations of our state, as measured by infalling observers, to come at a negligible cost in energy. So for the moment, just view this as a statement of effective field theory. If I have, let's suppose for simplicity, free fields propagating in a black hole background, and they begin in a Hartle-Hawking state, then I can add stuff way down near the horizon, which adds very little to the total energies measured by infinity. But if you're an infalling observer that goes past that blob of stuff, it can be enormous.
This we already knew at the time of Hawking, didn't
we? Absolutely. Most of this is ancient material recast with one goal, which is to demonstrate the size of the state-dependent effect needed to render generic or typical states having smooth horizons. Yes, most of what I have to say is completely old technology. Okay, just to make the point sharp, I'm going to start with a toy model calculation. There are some physical problems with the toy model, but we'll fix them up in a moment. But just to show you how we're going to make use of this ancient, well-known large redshift effect, let's consider for the moment, again, let's say a free field theory propagating a black hole background. For simplicity, I'll make it a fermionic field, okay? So that there are only, so that for a given mode of the field, there are only two states, occupied and unoccupied. Then if I restrict to, then a given mode of a fermionic field, think of it as a given eigenfrequency of the Schwarzschild time, it will be entangled with some mode in the interior. And if I just truncate the state to the mode outside and what it's entangled with inside, then it looks like this. This is a thermal field double type state with where I simply introduce this parameter x, which is E, which is the Boltzmann factor. Okay. So here we are. And for concreteness, let's say I'm going to introduce my excitation by acting with a unitary operator U written in terms of the number operator for this state. You'll notice that since the number operator is just 0 and 1, oh, this is the number operator for the outside part, and the outside part for me is the untilded part. So all this does is multiply this thing by minus 1. Okay? So there it is. It's a different state, right? Okay.
But so is this U supposed to be something that that the infaller is acting on the state with?
No, this is just math.
Okay, but of course there are lots of states of the same energy.
I'm giving you one.
Okay.
Which I will use for a particular purpose. And actually, I could have done this in many different ways. You're right, this is not particularly special. Okay. I'm simply pointing out that we can change the state away from the vacuum to something else. Okay. With, in this I have 10 minutes, I'm supposed to be fast. It will become clear, I hope, what the purpose is. So this U, in this simple model of a free field propagating a black hole background, adds no energy whatsoever and makes a new state. New state. Okay. It has some overlap with the old state, the inner product is not zero, and it has some probability not to be the old state. So as described in this field theory on a black hole background, the part of this which is orthogonal to this gives the probability that an infalling observer will experience this state as excited. It happens to be this number.
So that's your definition of excited? That would also be attained by Hamiltonian evolution in this toy model.
I'm not sure what you mean. In this toy model, if the toy model is free fermions on a black hole background, where I simply allocated the model to a certain set of modes, then if by Hamiltonian I'm not sure about Hamilton.
He means this thing. He means this thing.
Yeah, I mean, in the situation where you really had two different theories which were entangled, one was the tilde and one was the ordinary one.
Yes.
And you evolved with one of the two Hamiltonians, you would generate this minus sign, the phases. I mean, this is like these time shifted thermofield states. So you need the finite end effects to say it's excited. No,
this is Rindler physics.
This is
totally Rindler physics.
This is Rindler.
If I take Rindler space and I rotate some modes, I think
there's
really
something, there's something interesting about gravity. Gravity.
He's not talking about that. He's just talking about.
This is my simple model. We're just doing Rindler physics. This is the physics on one time slice, if you will, of a Rindler. Actually, I prefer to describe it as. If this is the Hartle-Hawking state, then this is not. And so in any sense, this is a Hartle-Hawking state. This is not.
When you say identical energy, this isn't an energy eigenstate, is it?
In my toy model, it is. As I said, I'll fix this up. In my toy model, this was a state, this was a mode of definite frequency in the Schwarzschild sense. And so the Hawking particle has some definite energy, it's an energy eigenstate, and the partner behind the horizon it's entangled with has a similar but negative energy. So my toy model, this is an energy eigenstate.
So what do you mean by the probability to be excited by the
inner product?
I mean that this is locally the vacuum state is experienced by some observer. And so this is not. Okay? This is the probability that this is not the vacuum state is given by the norm of the orthogonal projection of this state onto the space orthogonal to this one.
Can I ask, what's your next slide?
What I mean is, maybe you like this answer better. If you're an infalling observer and you have an under DeWitt detector that couples two things that, in terms of your proper time, have roughly this frequency, this fermionic field, then this is the probability your detector clicks. Okay, great. So what I really would like, just for cleanliness, is to apply a unitary operator much like the one I had before, but to get a state which has probability 1 to be excited, which is completely orthogonal to the vacuum. As a technical trick, one can do that if one assumes that you have two copies of this, two pairs of modes, and if you use an operator sort of in this form, and then you adjust the parameter theta accordingly. So you can generalize the previous construction such that you acting on your original Hartle-Hawking state gives you something orthogonal to the original state. So this is unit probability to be excited in this sense. Your detector, if you couple appropriately to the two pairs of modes, will click with one kind of particle or the other. All right. So, in the toy model I just described, I described it in terms of modes of definite frequency eigenmodes. Now, working with such things is a bit problematic because it turns out that in the black hole context, a mode of definite Schwarzschild frequency oscillates an infinite number of times near the horizon. And so if you go back and change that phase, as I did, you make the state sort of horribly bad in the ultraviolet near the horizon. So we'd like to fix that. We'd like to work with some better set of degrees of freedom in the effective field theory. It's not a problem. All we do is choose some mode outside the horizon which is not of definite frequency and which has the property, more precisely, we choose a mode outside the horizon whose wave function goes to zero at the horizon. Let's say it goes to zero in some neighborhood of the horizon just to be clean. Okay? Then it will not have definite frequency, but you can choose to make the spread in frequencies, the uncertainty frequencies, small. And there's nothing that stops us from making it small compared with, for example, the Hawking temperature of the black hole. So you can make that small. Okay. I'll go on with my kind of free field model. I will note that the operator that I applied back in this page here was written only in terms of number operators that are defined outside the black hole. They're not inside. So if I'm working in ADS-CFT type context, I can use the effective field theory outside the black hole to evolve those operators to infinity, say by using something like the HKLL construction or some mode sum. By relating it to something at infinity, one of my assumptions was that things at infinity act as standard state independent operators. So this argues that even if you thought that each black hole state with a smooth horizon had its own little Hilbert space with its own effective field theory degrees of freedom, because I can map it to infinity, there should be a single operator U, which is unitary, and which performs the transformation I just described on each of those little Hilbert spaces.
What if you can only map it to infinity in some coarse-grained way where you miss out on basically that H micro factor that Eric talked about?
Well, you miss out on...
So you're thinking that you map precisely this operator to a definite operator in the CFT?
Well...
Or are you saying only when you look at some subspace of degrees of freedom in the CFT, you know what the operator is?
You know, here's the question. You've got some operators at infinity. Effective field theory would allow you to relate it to operators at the horizon. Mm-hmm. Okay? So I'm going to assume that that's a pretty good approximation to the physics. Okay.
If it's not, non-perturbative correction.
Yeah.
Oh, there should be some tiny corrections. Okay. But if that's not a good approximation, then if you're in there in the space-time, flying around the black hole, making measurements, your experiences won't be described by effective field theory. So it's got to be a good approximation. All right. So, where are we here? So there's some U, which, I'll say it Ted's way, is a linear state-independent operator that acts in the Hilbert space, which, to a very good approximation, implements the transformation I just described on every little Hilbert space. And therefore, it turns every state which was conjectured to behave like the Hartle-Hawking vacuum into something where infalling observers see excitations at the horizon. Okay. So that's not so good, it turns out, or at least it leads to the following issue. Now, because my modes here were not exact frequency eigenstates, acting with U will add some energy. If I started with states that had energy less than some quantity E naught, then we add some energy which, if I do this in a single mode, adds an energy roughly delta omega. So this increases, so if I had this Hilbert space here with the spectrum below E naught, I'm now up a little bit. I have a slightly larger Hilbert space to work with. But the key point is that it's not that much larger, measured in a fractional sense. The change in the entropy is given by the first law of thermodynamics, it's delta E over the temperature, and if I choose that frequency spread to be small compared to the temperature, then this number is small. So I can expand the exponential, the dimension of the ratio of the dimensions of the two Hilbert spaces, given by this exponential, I can expand that exponential, and it's 1 plus delta E over T naught. If I take delta omega small, then I'm going to call this some small number epsilon. So the point is, I started in a given Hilbert space, I acted with some unitary operator, I'm now in a larger Hilbert space, but the dimension of the larger Hilbert space is bigger by a factor of 1 plus epsilon, where epsilon is small. Okay. Well, we're almost done now. The issue I want to focus on arises if I now consider the larger Hilbert space I'm living in. Let me now consider all states with energy less than E naught plus my delta E. Okay. So we have the following situation. Again, this Hilbert space is bigger by a factor of just 1 plus epsilon relative to the states I started with energy E naught. Now, since what I did was to take the original Hilbert space, which by assumption, typical states are experienced as the Hartle-Hawking vacuum by infalling observers, and acted on them with U. Well, of course, acting with a unitary transformation preserves the dimension of the Hilbert space. So what I've built is another Hilbert space inside my raised energy Hilbert space, which has the same dimension as the original one, and is therefore, again, smaller than my E plus delta E Hilbert space by a factor of 1 plus epsilon. But where in that Hilbert space, everything is experienced as excited, because it's the image under my excitation map, my U, of this Hilbert space, where by assumption everything was just like the Hartle-Hawking vacuum. So now, a large fraction of this Hilbert space, in terms of counting dimension, should be experienced as excited by infallers. It should be experienced as infalling excited.
Don, where does this argument break down if there's not a large ridge?
Well, it's basically delta E is large.
Sorry?
Delta E is large. If there's not a large redshift, then you get a large shift in energy. Let me put it this way.
And why can't I just compensate for that by choosing which operators I think are relevant at the boundary?
I'm not sure what you mean. Let me explain it this way. When I say that the infalling observer experiences a large effect, what I mean is not only will there be essentially unit probability for them to be hit by a particle, but I can choose the energy of the particle as experienced by that infaller to be a large number. I can guarantee that you're going to be hit by gamma rays when you fall into the black hole.
I just don't see how everything you said doesn't apply to every ordinary situation, like falling onto the surface of a planet. I mean, I can arrange for there to be a gas of particles that are going to hit me around the planet if I'm allowed to adjust the state to begin with.
Yeah, but doesn't it going to cost you energy? The weird thing here is you have these things which are locally bad, but they have arbitrarily small energy at infinity.
Mark, it is just true that a typical state in a system that satisfies eigen state thermalization hypothesis or some such thing, okay, we'll have, for our planet, we'll have a gas of particles around. And you hit them.
When you hit the sun, you also die.
Yeah. Is it the same effect? Okay. The thing is that the prize here, or the thing which can trip you up, is, I mean, if we spend a lot of time in teaching quantum field theory and curved space-time, explaining them in the Hartle-Hawking state, the Hawking radiation particles are not sort of real at the horizon. If you fall in as a geodesic infaller, you don't actually hit them. Okay? But the point of this argument is to say that if you have a context where you have a finite dimensional Hilbert space, and you can turn them on in this way, you can argue that you do hit.
How did we end up here?
Didn't Hawking tell us that we should assume?
Let me finish my presentation just for a moment. I'm almost done.
Your total time is up, so you really need to finish.
My total time is up. Oh my goodness. All right, well this is the issue. So what we have here is we've got this larger Hilbert space, a Hilbert space which is a tiny bit smaller. It's down by a factor of one plus epsilon, in which everything that experiences excited. And so, well, that's now a problem, because the assumption was that the generic state in this larger Hilbert space experienced is unexcited. But it's just the fact that if you take a generic state with respect to the round measure of the Hilbert sphere, and you ask what is its overlap, what is its inner product, with a part of a linear subspace smaller by a factor of 1 plus epsilon, it's large. It's almost 1. I won't go through the calculation, come out of time, but this quote sort of summarizes. But typical states for soon to be vacuum. So here, the Born rule would tell you you have a large probability to experience these states as excited, 1 plus epsilon over 2, whereas the conjecture was that these states are essentially unexcited, experiences the Hartle-Hawking vacuum. So that's an issue. All right, so this is just a summary of what I said. We're in the situation where typical states for each pair of modes are claimed or assumed to be experienced as vacuum, but also differ by only about epsilon from states that are experienced as excited. So this is a large violation of the Born rule of quantum mechanics. I also wanted to quickly mention a sense in which this is an observable effect as seen by an infalling observer. You can imagine if, by using a large number of modes, I previously talked about just one set of modes, but if you copy this problem into many, many, many separate modes, you could encode into this kind of, does it feel like it's excited or does it feel like it's Hartle-Hawking question, a long message. You could play Beethoven's Ninth Symphony in binary notation or something, okay? And I could set up a black hole where there's some set of modes that encodes that, and then I can imagine throwing someone into it to check what happens. Okay? And although I'm happy to assume that when they fall into the black hole, they're sort of destroyed and you can only measure that one black hole, by verifying that my large number of modes does properly encode Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, okay, they will obtain a large amount of evidence that this highly nonlinear theory of physics is correct. So that's a sense in which this can be used. Good. Thank you.
He could have already written down all of those other states that you're talking about here and said those are all black hole states and therefore there's no regular writing. I mean, what made us even end up in the idea that typical states would be expected?
I don't know.
who said this? I mean, not for what I prefer, I think this is a physics question. What happens when I put a black hole there and I go and fall in?
Yes.
Will it occupy a typical state or will it occupy a state? I mean, that's the physics question. And then the microscopic Hamiltonian is important. I claim if you start from any of your typical state, it will relax into a state where you will not see anything with the horizon due to gravity. And this is simply just a question of dynamics.
As I said, I don't understand how that can possibly be true under unitary evolution, which is
the
state.
It's just the way that if you put this state here, you let it radiate, you let it create its equilibrium with its outside, eventually it will be an equilibrium state, and it will be the state that you would like to have.
Well, we should probably discuss this offline. By state counting, it seems that in your scenario, at any given time in your equilibration process, most of the states should be non-equilibrium. Don? Yeah.
So this looks very general. It sounds like you are saying, if you don't like firewalls, you have to give up ABS CFT.
Well, or like quantum.
You have to give up one assumptions. You have to give up, let's see, let me try to enumerate them. In this sense, you have to give up local effective field theory, or you must give up ABS CFT, or I left some wiggle room here.
When you say give up local effective field theory, you mean really in the firewall fashion, not in the less violent fashion,
I'm saying that
you'd be okay with something more non-violent. You'd be okay with non-violent.
That's a different question. Your non-violent, non-locality scenario is not subject to this discussion because it does not have assumption one.
So assumption one is what's violated in fuzz rules.
I'm not sure I can answer that universally for the fuzzball community.
Well, let's put it to work.
There are two parts to assumption one. There's the effective field theory works in the typical states. It works in typical states. I mean, so I guess I would say the assumption I would give up is that the typical state has a smooth black hole horizon. That doesn't mean I have to give up the CFT.
That's what I'd like to give up too.
I think the exact fact that there's the internal black hole where we have to give that up as well. You know, what do we do? You know, it's very easy to say, that's why I think we introduced the internal black hole. It's easy to say we give up the idea that a generic state in high energy doesn't have a smooth horizon. But you also then look at the internal black hole. And then just one parameter family of states. You don't have to look at all states in the CFT, just states which have shifted. And one has to answer what happens to those states. Are those states firewall states or not? So I think we can't just say, you know, we assume the generic states are firewalls. That's not sufficient to get rid of these paradoxes. These paradoxes appear in just the one parameter set of states
which are related. As you said, if you go with the phenomenon that Aaron and I called super selection sectors, you don't need state dependence for.
Super selection sector says that if I'm living in a pure state in my CFT, just a pure state which is not entangled, somebody else can come and hit me. That doesn't make any sense. If you have an energy eigenstate, just eigenstate.
I disagree with the actual words you said, but this may be a discussion to have offline.
The super selection sectors lead to a wormhole and in unentangled eigenstate pairs.
Yes, that is true.
So that's the statement that I'm living in a CFT, which is in an energy eigenstate.
No, it is not, because in the super selection sector story, if you are a bulk observer that falls into a wormhole, you do not live in one of the CFTs.
But fine, but the CFT, the super selection sector is also unentangled with this. There's just some, there's some experiment you can do in one CFT.
It's not in one CFT. The bulk observers that feel things inside the wormhole are described by operators that require both of your CFTs.
I mean, do we have an understanding of what these super selection sectors are and how many of them are required?
No, we do not. No, we do not.
So the statement ADS is not equal to CFT.
I think we have one other question over here. So, can you apply these U operators not exactly at the horizon? So, in the near horizon region?
And that's actually what I did.
Okay, so it's valid as long as the relative boost is high? So,
relative boost. It's a question of the redshift here.
Yeah,
but my goal was to achieve a small change in the energy.
So, I mean, as long as you're within a radius of curvature away from the horizon?
If you want to really make the change in energy is small, you need to go, your distance to the horizon has to be small compared to the radius of curvature.
Yeah.
But go down by a factor of 1,000 or something.
10.
You need to act on modes that are actually excited, right? I mean, otherwise, modes that are populated non-trivially, that aren't Boltzmann suppressed.
That's also true. That's also
true. The one, just random modes far from the black hole or, very high energy.
A simple point. So this Shankar Stanford shortwave, is that an example of this? I mean, of a low energy perturbation?
It can be turned into one, and Douglas has liked to talk about some things like that recently, much the same effect. And the real issue is, again, just the large redshift. So yes, if you do, you can do what looks like a low energy Shankar Stanford shockwave that is actually experienced as a strong pulse near the horizon.
Yeah.
And because it almost doesn't change the redundancy metrics of each side, it is a unitary, like what you said.
Oh yes. You can use that. So you're free to use that unitary operator as well. It's not so different from what I thought.
A free field model doesn't do justice to this, because if you thought of the eternal black hole and you did this on one side, and you really took a free field limit where it was really Hamiltonian evolution, you might have imagined that adding phases leads the following observer to experience something bad, but actually it doesn't. And adding phases to the thermofield double state leads the geometry small.
So you clearly should not take the model to that extreme.
Right, so you shouldn't. So the free field model is somehow missing the fact that gravitational back reaction can sometimes small.
I'm not quite sure I followed that statement. The free field model is certainly going to miss anything that involves it misses effects that are relevant at 1/n levels. So it's certainly not going to be correct at exponentially fine levels.
No, but I think in Rindler you would have thought that if you added phases to the Rindler state,
yes,
you would get something that had a firewall at the Rindler horizon.
It's true. If you add phases to the Rindler state, you get a firewall.
But in the presence of gravity, if you add phases to the thermofield double state, you do not get a firewall.
No, but you can make it large enough to notice it, but not large enough to back react, right?
No, this is just a different story. Suprad is commenting on acting with two different notions of time translation operators, and they're different notions of time translation operators. If you have a bulk field through a black hole background, which is some Rindler-type description, you could attempt to time translate one wedge without the other. And in a field through a black hole on a Rindler background, it's a very singular thing to do.
Yes.
If instead you have a gravitational theory with two boundaries, you have an R cross R asymptotic time translation symmetry, you can act with one and not the other, and it does something non-singular. That's simply because in the gravitational case, when you're acting with your time translation, you do two things. One, you change the state of the quantum fields on this side. Two, you change the geometry of the slice you're looking at and you bend the slice. Whereas in the case where you're just working with quantum fields on a given background, you can change the state of the quantum fields, but you can't bend the slice to compensate.
Yes, I agree with that. But I'm just saying that that's something that would be missed in the free field model. Related to that, I just want to ask,
I don't understand what you mean missed in the free field.
I think the issue is, so you had this, your analysis was essentially field theory in Rindler space,
yeah,
and there it was extremely convincing. So then the question is, do you have an additional symmetry or an additional freedom in gravity that would allow you to say that this new state morally is not orthogonal because it's related by a large diffeomorphism? In field theory, it's not. But what you're doing is, say in the limit where you live.
You haven't changed the gravitational degrees of freedom that describe the shape of your surface.
I think the tilde.
He chose his state. He gets to choose them.
Well, the thing you can do in the CFT,
yes,
which is acting with unitary operators that do not change the energy, is always equivalent to time evolution. Now, I think you're right. No, that's the only thing you can do without literally changing the energy.
That's right. But I did change the energy.
Suppose he changes some modes and not others.
Yeah.
Does that do away with this issue?
So I think the question is, to measure this NA mode,
no,
this is
the
only
thing.
But I think the back reaction may not be something which is so simple, because to measure this NA mode, you need to measure it over a time, which is log n, which I think in the two-scale coordinates is n. So you need to measure something which is another large volume thing inside. It's not clear to me that the fact that you change these modes, you get a stress tensor at the horizon, now you resolve the Hamiltonian constraint. In the moment you rotate these phases, I would get some stress tensor at the horizon.
Yes.
Then I resolve the Hamiltonian constraint, so
yes,
I get a new metric.
Yes.
And one could ask, if I now redefine my observables relationally with respect to the new metric, given that I have to measure some very long time evolution to see this NA, is there a back reaction that smooths out the naive
effect? I have control over all these parameters. I mean, yes, if I want to make the effect of the horizon large enough that it completely annihilates anyone who falls in, there'll be some large back reaction. But if I just want to make it large enough that Mark falling in will be hit by one gamma ray coming out of a large black hole, that's not a large back reaction in geometry.
But I think that's not what's happening. To measure this NA, I don't think you measure it locally at the horizon. To measure the operator, you need to measure it. You need to measure a field over a time period.
But he's not measuring N. He's acting with N.
I understand.
And then he's just jumping in and
measuring
NA. You're talking about NA. To measure NA, not NB.
Yeah, where are the deviations from the vacuum become apparent? Do they become apparent before the observer crosses the horizon, or he must cross the horizon?
He must cross it.
I'm playing with the entanglement between things outside and things inside. So you must cross the horizon to see that.
But I think it's a very non-local measurement you have to see.
It's just as local as anything else we do talking about measuring particles in quantum fields in curved space.
If it's a gamma ray, you must cross the horizon
by an amount comparable to the wavelength of the gamma ray before the experiment is
completed.
So,
Subra,
for this dog, you need to cross the horizon by an end. If you want to keep the energy log n, you need to actually cross the horizon by a length scale that's n, not so small.
It's not n.
How do you measure? Let's
not mention n's. Suppose I have chosen to make the frequency spread small compared to the black hole temperature by a factor of 10.
Yes.
Okay, good. Then I'm going to call that a gamma ray experienced by Mark when he falls in, because gamma rays fall into a window of the spectrum which has several orders of magnitude. Okay. And to get delta omega to be a tenth of the Hawking temperature, what I need is to get roughly, I have a wave packet with roughly 10 oscillations, something that looks like a Rindler eigenstate, if you will, over 10 oscillations. And those modes oscillate sort of logarithmically. So if the shortest wavelength, if the last oscillation on the outside has a wavelength which is a gamma ray wavelength, then the entire supportify wave packet has a length which is twice that, or so.
E to the 1 by delta omega in
Kruskal
coordinates. I mean, you have to measure the time, which is 1 over delta omega.
It's a proper distance of roughly twice the wavelength of the last oscillation. And in terms of someone's proper time, that's how much proper time is required. We can go back and check various coordinate systems later. But the proper time, but if I want something that Marco experiences a gamma ray, the proper time he requires to interact with it, okay, to get hit by it with probably 1, is a few times a gamma ray wavelength. It's not large.
Let me suggest a homework problem. Take an Unruh detector and drop it through the horizon in one of these states. It clicks.
You're talking about a field theory homework problem. So,
yeah, that's
so
right.
The only confusion is whether diffeomorphisms change the story.
But you work in the limit where you're doing perturbation theory, right? So you can parametrically suppress the back reaction.
Well, that's not so clear. I mean, maybe you can simply suppress it. You get something that's small. So it's not so clear. I mean, maybe you can suppress it, but I think it's something that you know that's not so obvious. That's one question. The second question, maybe you can ask. Sure. Does this work just as well if you had a unitary operator that was creating these, the so-called unpaired states, the zero, tilde, one, or the one, tilde, zero, if it makes you with those? I presume it looks like it's a very general argument. So it wasn't critical. But we raise the energy. We change the energy a bit more.
Because Steve wants to leave the state on the outside, reduce the signature outside, completely unchanged.
Well, you've got to act with an operator that's only outside, too.
So that's what's hard to do.
Right.
Oh, no, you can do that. You just switch 0 and 1 outside.
But that changes the energy.
Okay, so it was. Okay, so the argument was special to these sort of paired states.
And that's what makes it simplest.
The other thing is, it's not really the case that an infaller will measure violations of the bond rule. I thought that at least in the paper, what you had was do experiments with all sorts of microstates and tabulate the results, and then you will see that this is a nonlinear operation.
What we said in the paper. If you can imagine someone, I can rig up a black hole, in which I perform this U operation on some large set of modes. Some of them I perform it, some of them I don't. And so I use this structure to encode a long message into the Hawking, into the radiation outside the black hole. And it's just true that if you give me a theory, okay, which is state dependent, I could then use that to prepare a complicated experiment for an infaller to interact with and check your theory, and by if your theory is correct, they will obtain a large number of bits of evidence that your theory is correct, and thus that physics is nonlinear.
So what the person really sees is an effective field theory works, and that the person sits outside and acts with some e to the I and omega theta. So let's say we live in a.
Let me explain. Okay. I have in mind that you give me many. Let's do the ADS CFT story. We have many of these CFTs in our laboratory. Okay. We set them up into the states that into a large number of different states. One of them, you tell me, is going to be experienced as a vacuum if the person falls in. Another one will experience as excited. Another one is experienced as excited, unexcited, excited, unexcited, etc. in many different modes. Excuse me?
You have to set up the e to the n squared copies. Because if I was living in a vacuum...
I set up a lot of copies.
E to the n squared copies, I think.
Depends what I want to do. Okay. If I merely want to check that two states that you claim will be experienced as physically very different are in fact very close in the Hilbert space, I only need two copies. I need two copies. I run some interference experiment, and I find that, yes, they were in almost the same quantum state, the same, the CFT state differed by some tiny amount. Okay. And then my statement is that having determined that the state that you declare is experienced as the Hartle-Hawking state, another one that you declare is experiencing some very complicated pattern of excited and unexcited, having determined that those two things are basically parallel in the Hilbert space, I choose to jump into the complicated state. And if indeed it has the pattern of excitations that it was supposed to have, I have accumulated a lot of evidence that your theory is correct. And thus, the physics is highly relevant.
The statement that these two states are parallel in the Hilbert space is not something that a new falling observer, in fact, you can determine with an effective field theory at all. I mean,
that is correct.
So it's something that has to go beyond effective. You have to have a super observer in the CFT, and only such a super observer can determine these violations of the boundary.
I think we said the same thing. Okay? Yes, you need a large, you need to have the ability to manipulate.
All bits, all e to the n squared degrees of freedom.
I disagree with that. You give me two states, psi 1 and psi 2. I'll let you make them in your laboratory.
And I'll let you measure correlators of effective field theory and what psi 1 is.
No. But you make them in your laboratory, okay, and you give them to me, but they have to be the states that I asked for, okay, and therefore, there are states that are in fact almost the same in the CFT. So my statement is just that if I live outside those CFTs and I can couple, for example, a spin system to these states, I can prepare the following state. Here's my spin system. I will correlate it with your states.
Could you prepare it in white chalk?
That would be probably better. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. So I will prepare it in this state. Okay, so I make that state. And now I choose to measure my spin not in the up-down basis, but in the left-right basis. And because psi 1 and psi 2 are almost parallel, I will have high probability to find the spin is pointing left, and zero probability to find it pointing right.
So this is more complicated, because now you have to redo the whole description for the entangled state, for this system, which is...
So far, I am only verifying experimentally that your two states are almost parallel in the Hilbert space. So we can verify that using this procedure if we live outside the system. Great. Okay. So my statement is, having verified that, I want to take this state, actually just this, so that we'll imagine throwing this away. You give me a new, clean copy of the system in this state, which is the one where you've told me that an infalling observer will see a certain pattern of radiation coming out of the black hole. And I will now jump into that state and verify that I see the pattern you're predicting.
There's a sharp question, which I think is if you give me any state, including a state where the CFT is entangled with something else, and I let you measure correlation functions of these effective field theory operators, do those correlation functions, do you see signs of this in those correlation functions?
There are many questions. I'm addressing the one I'm talking about.
Okay, but this is something that goes beyond effective field theory for a single infalling observer.
No,
that's... restrict to the CFT and can manipulate all sorts of states. And
okay,
can...
fine. I'm happy with that. I agree that in order for this to be useful, we have to have the ability to manipulate the states, and in some sense, we are, at least at this first stage, sitting outside the CFT. Very good.
And have arbitrary thought, yeah.
Yeah. Now, I imagine, you may disagree with this, I imagine that story is a good model for what a supremely powerful observer could do in, say, the asymptotically flat context, if they could build a black hole, put it in a box, and then manipulate it in some very sophisticated quantum gravity way while remaining outside.
Okay, that I would probably disagree
with. Before we turn off the recording, Daniel would like me to record that point one is essentially my point of view, although it's more natural in other examples. It corresponds to doing his point three and only doing the second measurement.
Oh, good.
Anyway, I just had to get it on the recording. That's all.
Actually, and for the same purposes, let me mention, actually, you know what? I don't think this got recorded. But anyway, for the same purposes.
Never mind.
Hidden microphones.
For the same purpose, I will mention that I meant to say that, you know, the basic point that I was emphasizing here, that there are large violations of the Born rule in the sense that there are states that are almost parallel, which are physically different, is something that Dan also emphasized in his paper a year and a bit ago. The difference is just that Dan took care to write things very carefully in the context of a certain formalism. We took less care to write things less carefully, but from a bird's eye point of view, we're just not tied to a certain formalism. Thank you.
I'd like to also just call attention again to Suvrat's last slide. So those of you who are more interested in entanglement than black holes, he's raised a very interesting question. The entire, you know, operator equals entropy. You've got to fix that. You Ryutaki Nagi people have to fix that.